Hi, I'm Terry Virts, STS-130 pilot, and you're watching NASA TV.
Good morning to you, Terry.
Good morning, Houston, and thank you very much for that song to my beautiful wife, Stacy, and thanks to my kids, Matthew and Stephanie, also. It's another great day to be in space.
We certainly agree, Terry.
Today's music for the wake-up call to the crew on board Space Shuttle Endeavour, the song I'm Gonna Be 500 Miles by Stephen Curtis Chapman, played today for a pilot, Terry Virts. He and his crewmates up to begin flight day 12 on orbit, a day when they will wrap up the transfers between the shuttle and the International Space Station and close the hatches after delivering the last components of the U.S. segment of the station.
Hello, everyone. You all look great. This is Jill Tolk representing the Beacon Villager in Maynard, Massachusetts. A question for Nick Patrick from Air Race pilot Michael Goulian. Michael says, just being there to watch the launch for two nights in a row with changeable weather was a roller coaster of emotions. When you get so close to a launch and it's delayed like it was last week, how do you get psyched up to do it all over again the next night?
That's a good question, and hello to Mike. I'm glad he was able to watch with us. We were a little disappointed, obviously, to come off the launch pad in our suits rather than being pushed off it by the main engines and the solid rockets the first night. But it's not hard to get psyched up again when you know what's ahead. The second night was maybe even better than the first because we were all well prepared, having just been through the night before, and the launch went off the second time without a hitch. So I would say it's not hard to get really psyched up a second time for a launch like that.
Thanks for the good words. Another question for you, Nick. Before your launch, we had talked about Captain James Cook and his vessel, the HMB Endeavour. I did find out that Andy Thomas flew a wooden piece of the anchor from Cook's Endeavour on Shuttle Endeavour in 1996. So what were your thoughts and feelings as you were sailing through your first EVA in view of your childhood growing up in Yorkshire?
Well, in fact, somewhere through the EVA, our IV, Steve Robinson, pointed out that we were over London at dawn, and I was able to look down and see a large part of the UK below me. I didn't, at that point, have too much time to think about my childhood because the EVAs are very busy, as you know. But reflecting now, it was a wonderful experience to have grown up in that part of the world. It prepares you well for any weather you might encounter, whether it's bad weather at launch or landing. And I do remember fondly going up to see the monument to Captain Cook in the Yorkshire Moors, which was, it's a treat to look back on that and think about how far we've come since his days of exploration.
Thanks very much. My last question is for Steve and Soichi. Stevie Ray, before you launched, you talked about being one brain with Soichi because of your experience on 114. What's it been for you and Soichi together to work and maybe play a little bit on orbit?
Well, you know what you don't hear too much about in the space program, I suppose. You know, you hear about rockets and space stations and international cooperation, but, you know, there's real true friendship in the space program. And to travel that far from the surface of the Earth up to this tiny little star in the heavens and find my friends on board is almost miraculous. And so it's been wonderful for me to see all the folks here on board. And Suichi and I, of course, we trained together for so long. We're like brothers from other countries, and it's been great fun.
Yeah, thanks. You know, living in space is nothing more joyful other than having friends on board. And Steve Ray just gave me a great memory 5 years ago, and this time also. It's a great experience.
This is Gerhard Daum with the German Aerospace Center, DLR, and Space Expo Association. Question for TJ Creamer. After about 2 months aboard the ISS, what were your most challenging moments and your highlights so far?
After 2 months, my first response is, wow, 2 months already? Most challenging, I tell you that everything we do around here, it's amazing how much we miss gravity. What I mean is you put something down and it, of course, doesn't stay down because it doesn't know where down is. And so everything we do is has an overhead associated with that activity that is just really surprising, and it takes a while to get used to. Highlights, I tell you, sharing the time with the friends that are on board, and truly, it's friendship all around. And I think the most spectacular aspect of that sharing is the discoveries from day to day that we encounter, and of course, the incredible views that we're able to see throughout my 2 months here, but now even better with Cupola.
Question for Nick Patrick. You performed your first three EVAs on that mission. Please tell me about your emotions and impressions floating outside the station and what was the most difficult task.
Well, it's EVAs are a challenge, as I'm sure you know, you've heard from other people. And I think my primary emotion was, wow, I can't believe I'm really out here doing this after a year of training. We had a lot of fun training in Houston with a great team. But it was hard at sometimes to believe that we'd actually get here and do these spacewalks and bring up the cupola and the Node 3. So half the time I had to pinch myself, which is hard to do through the suit, because I couldn't believe we were up here. I think the most challenging task from a big picture point of view was connecting the ammonia jumpers and wrapping the MLI around those. That took us the best part of a whole EVA. And the single most challenging moment was probably when Bob and I were rolling up the MLI on the outside of the cupola, the insulation that it launched in. That just didn't behave the way it had on Earth. So those were some of the challenging moments. But all in all, it was really great fun and a wonderful experience.
My last question for Steve Robinson. This is your fourth mission. Was there anything new for you personally on this mission so far?
What's new for me personally? Well, the space station must be almost twice the size as it was last time. The type of things that people do on space station, the type of living here, and of course, you know, the brand new Node 3 and the cupola, all these are new. So it's like a brand new experience all over again. And frankly, I think every time you fly in space, you sort of start over in a way. There's that much new to be learned.
This is Jim Oberg with NBC News, and hello to everyone up there. I have a question from our network associates in London, ITN, for Nick Patrick. So it's for British television, so you don't have to worry about Yankees understanding how you answer. But their question is, now that you're fulfilling that your lifelong dream for a second time, how does it really feel to be in the shuttle doing that work that you were carrying out, and how does it compare to your dreams? And later, what would you, as a follow-up, what would you say to someone else who has those same dreams? First, how does it compare to your dreams?
Those are interesting questions. Those are interesting questions. I could almost say I haven't quite fulfilled my childhood dream, because what I think most of us here dreamed of when we were really young was walking on the moon, when we watched the Apollo moon landings. And none of us has walked on the moon yet or on the surface of another planet. We'd all really love to do that. But of course, in a very real sense, we're all fulfilling our childhood dreams of flying in space, and it is just a wonderful experience. It's both wonderful to be here and experience it as a crew, and it's also wonderful when you get back home to share it with friends, family, and students and colleagues. The people who in the future will hopefully be inspired by what we're doing, and the people who've helped us do it. It's wonderful to go back and talk to all of them.
This is Marcia Dunn of the Associated Press, and I'd like some reviews of the station's new observation deck. How stunning are the views, and what are some of your favorite views through the seven windows so far? And maybe a couple of you could answer that, please.
It's going to be so hard to put into words the view that we see out those beautiful seven windows. I think the best way I can think of is it's comparing a black and white analog picture to a super high def color picture. It's just phenomenal what we can see out there. Although we really haven't spent a lot of time gazing out the windows yet because we're still working inside Node 3 to get it all operational. And the most stunning thing I've seen so far is just some beautiful thunderstorms from above. It's really interesting to watch the way the lightning just jumps from cloud to cloud far below us.
Hi, Marcia. I'll add to that. The first time, every experience I've had here has been new and completely amazing for me since this is my first flight. Getting a look out the shuttle windows and the station windows have been awesome. But when we looked out the cupola, like Kay said, it's impossible to put into words, but it took my breath away. And we've only had a few opportunities to go down there because we have been busy inside doing work. But I think the favorite view that I've had has been watching sunrise, because you can see at night, you can see cities if you're over land. And then when you pass into the sunlight, you get the blue limb. And then it turns into pink and different colors like that. And then when the sun pops up, it's like an instantaneous floodlight in your eyes that kind of overwhelms you. But the view is amazing. You can sit there and bend up and actually with your eyes at least perceive the entire Earth limb. And you can really see that the Earth is that round shape. It's just amazing.
Walking so you can use the cupola for viewing, or at least part of your crew. And how do you plan to handle the up and down of the shutters over the course of what's left of your mission and missions to come?
Well, obviously, we're going to have some restrictions. For example, we can't have the cupola open at when the shuttle undocks, and probably for about two orbits after that, after the shuttle leaves, just due to the potential for contamination from the thrusters from the shuttle. But we will use the cupola a lot to get a very unique and new viewpoint of the Earth that we haven't experienced before. And as the others just said, to be able to see the entire Earth in one glance and see the entire limb of the Earth all the way around and see the spherical shape of the Earth is going to be new to us. Obviously, we've seen a lot of those segments of that view before, but only one segment at a time through a narrower view of a field of view to the Earth. We will. We have taken a lot of photography up here. We will continue to do so. And the cupola will offer us a very unique and new opportunity for photography in a new way, particularly with wide-angle lenses, which we're already playing with a little bit to try to be able to share that experience with folks on Earth.
Hi, Nancy Atkinson from Universe Today, and I have some questions submitted by our readers. Speaking of the cupola, a lot of people in the northern latitudes have been seeing some aurora recently, and we were wondering if you have seen any from the space station.
Actually, unfortunately for the shuttle crew here, for the 130 crew, we haven't had an opportunity to see aurora since they've docked. But about a month ago, I think it was, we had some beautiful aurora over the North Pole. And some of us have experienced it also on previous flights, and both in the North Pole and the South Pole. But this about a month ago, it was particularly stunning over Canada and parts of Russia as well.
Another thing everybody seems to want to know is to know more about the internet that's on the space station now. Do you have access to any website, or do you have some that are blocked? And people are wondering what kind of download speeds you have.
thanks for asking for this project that many people have worked on to make this possible for us, and some have just pulled their hairs out to make it successful. And many thanks go to these folks. We have access to any website that we are allowed to go to as government employees. That's my best answer. And in terms of download speeds, you know, back in the old days, it kind of compares to the modems, the 9.6 kilobyte and the 14.4 kilobyte modems. So it's not really fast enough to do good file exchange or large file exchange or videos, but it certainly lets us go out and browsing and to do the fun reading that we want to do and get caught up in current events on that day. It's a nice outreach for us. And of course, you've heard about the Twittering, which that's a nice feature that we can partake in also.
And one final question for the shuttle crew. We want to know the significance of the chickens that were in some of the execute packages.
Okay, I think what the consensus is that we're not seeing those front pages. It's probably on the front page of the execute package that we don't get, so it's possibly an inside joke that we are not on the inside of, and we'll find out when we get back.
Hey, thanks, guys. It's Bill Harwood with CBS News with two questions. One for Jeff Williams. You know, with the cupola and Node 3 there, the station is virtually complete structurally anyway. I guess you still have the MPLM coming up at the end, but can you give us a little state of the ISS and how you guys are feeling about reaching what is really an amazing milestone given all the work that's gone into this?
You're absolutely right, Bill. It is an amazing milestone, and this is an absolutely incredible facility. The first time I visited it was just under 10 years ago. It was two modules at the time. It was before Expedition 1 launched, so it was unmanned. We came in and it was hot and smelly because the air had been stale for about a year or so. And then, of course, in Expedition 13, back here a few years ago, and it was about, the living space was about half the size it is now. It's virtually doubled in size and has grown both in the U.S. orbiting segment with the Japanese and European modules, as well as, of course, Node 3 now and Node 2, which we're in right now, as well as some growth in the Russian segment. It's an amazing facility. It's very rewarding for all of us to be here at this stage as we really transition from assembly to full utilization. And we all look forward to reaping the benefits of the utilization over the next 10 years or so.
Thanks. And one last one from KSC, and I'll ask this from one of the spacewalkers. Can one of you guys compare the view through your helmet to the view through the cupola? I'm just trying to get a sense if that room, you know, is even close to what an EVA is like. Thanks.
Well, that's a great question, and it's one that Nick Patrick was able to answer immediately following our third spacewalk. Immediately coming out of his suit, he was able to go over to the cupola and actually have a look out of the window and compare it. And I think his words were that it's at least comparable, if not better. The reason being that you actually have time to look around through all of the windows. Usually during a spacewalk, there's a fair amount of work to get done. You know, it's important for us to get out and on this flight get Node 3. It's a cooling system and it's electrical power hooked up, and so there wasn't a lot of time for the sightseeing that you might like to do out of a window like cupola. The other thing that the cupola affords you is the opportunity to share some of those views with other people. We're really limited on the photography that we can do during a spacewalk, but taking one of the HD cameras or some still photos inside of the cupola is really going to allow us to share those beautiful sunrises and sunsets and Earth views in general with everyone on the ground. Great question.
Hi, this question's for Nick Patrick. Nick, this is Shona from ITV News. Just explain to me the journey, looking up at the stars as a boy in England and thinking, you know, one day I want to be a spaceman. And even though you're not sort of stereotypically walking on the moon as you might have thought about it then, just take us through how it feels to actually be there now.
It's really hard to describe. It's a little hard to believe that after all these years, I think for any of us, that we really made it to space. We've all been pursuing this dream for a long, long time, wherever we came from, whether it's Japan or North America, England, and Russia. That's right. We have cosmonauts with us today. It's an amazing set of things that have to go right. And people who want to pursue this path really need to study hard. I think that's the one thing that we all have in common, whether we're engineers, scientists, pilots, doctors. We've all really worked hard in school to get here. We've stayed in school for a long time, way too long for some of us. And we've been very fortunate in our careers to have followed paths that brought us here. But it really is amazing. You have to pinch yourself, and I can't wait to get back and share this unbelievable experience with everybody back on the planet.
That's great. And just another one for Nick, just briefly. Moving from the UK to the US is one thing, obviously, but space is pretty much the ultimate culture shock, surely. Do you sometimes dream of getting back to Saltburn-on-Sea? I mean, you're so far from home. How does space compare with a pint down the pub?
Well, I do look forward to getting back to Saltburn after the flight and talking to students there and explaining what spaceflight is really like. As for how this compares to a pint in a pub, I would have to say there's a lot of the same friendly atmosphere up here. We don't have as much time as you might to really sit back and share stories, but when we do, it's a very precious experience. Floating in the cupola, as Bob described, with a friend and looking out over a sunset, a view that few have been fortunate to see. It's if we had beer up here, it would make the best pub in the world.
My name is Imoto from TBS. Thank you. Mr. Noguchi, what's your impression of your stay in ISS so far and your activities so far?
Hi. Well,
it's been 2 months now since I've been here at the ISS, but everything has been working smoothly, and the people on the ground, especially those at SCUBA, we have been coordinating quite fine, and so we're very grateful for their support. And although the launch has been delayed, in April we'll be expecting Ms. Yamazaki to come, so we'll have to make preparations for that.
Thank you, media at JSC, KSC, NASA headquarters, and in Tokyo. ISS, we are now resuming normal radio audio communications.
Well, good afternoon. Today we are here in Tranquility, standing above the cupola, to formally open the cupola for use by other crews that will be here up on the space station. And arguably, mankind has been after this view for centuries, this perspective, this view of the world. And we finally have it, and we are going to take advantage and enjoy it.
And we on the station crew are especially happy to get this, to be able to enjoy it. I know for me personally, it's a milestone that I will remember for the rest of my life in terms of the experience on the station, because it culminates so much. It culminates just a beautiful view, a window on the world that we haven't had before. It culminates just about the assembly complete of the space station, getting us to full capability. So this cupola means a whole lot. We also want to take this a moment to remember a friend and co-worker and fellow astronaut, Lacey Veach, who was really dedicated to the early development of the cupola and its vision on the International Space Station. And we would like to leave his path. in memory of him and dedicated to him, as well as a picture on board the space station. The patch will be in the cupola, and the photograph of Lacey will go up on the airlock hatch.
We also have one more item to put in the cupola today. These are some moon rocks that were picked up on Apollo 11 and returned to Earth, and later carried to the summit of Mount Everest by Scott Berezinski. And so these moon rocks have had quite a journey, and they will continue their journey for thousands and millions of miles in a very short amount of time. They will be placed in the cupola as a reminder of man's reach and man's grit as they go out and explore.
So with that, George, how about if you cut the ribbon?
Sure.
And here we go. The cupola is open for business.
All right.
All right, everybody. Let's take a look.
This is Mission Control Houston. Station Commander Jeff Williams and Shuttle Commander George Zamka have dedicated the cupola and opened it up for business for each of the crew members, 11 crew members on board, to fly in and take a look out the windows. As we continue to watch the crew members look through the cupola window, Station Commander Jeff Williams had indicated that the cupola was being dedicated to astronaut Charles Lacey Veach. He was selected as an astronaut in May of 1984 and died in Houston in 1995 of cancer.
That concludes the formal ceremony.
Thank you very much, Jeff. And we weren't around when they were at Promontory, Utah, to drive in the final spike at the Intercontinental Railroad. And none of us were able to be there when they switched on the dynamos at the Hoover Dam. And we weren't around when they topped out the steel on the Empire State Building. But I think I speak for the whole flight control team in Houston and the flight control teams around the world that were really pleased to be in work in the last 2 weeks when we attached the final module to the U.S. segment and the 1 million-pound space station, and that was built by thousands of people around the world. So we only wish that we could be up there with you now.
And we share those sentiments as well, Hal, and our tremendous gratitude goes out to the entire international partnership and teams, like you said, around the world that make this thing possible. It's something that everybody is a part of, a very unique piece of history, and we are all honored to be part of it, and we want to recognize the many people on those teams, not only the op centers, which we've really enjoyed working with the last week and a half or so. You guys have been tremendous, and we thank you for that. And we also thank the people that are behind the scenes and the engineering teams and the design centers around the world doing the real-time support and operations and working through the problems and issues, which you do very well. That's what we're best at when we work when we run into the unexpected and work through them. And our congratulations to everybody, and our hats off to everybody. Thank you for your service to humankind, and congratulations on being part of this this history in the making.
Great words, Jeff.
Well, before we get going on our farewell, I just want to throw some names out, say hello, and thank them for their support of this mission. You don't get two modules activated and three EVAs and get an amazing view out of cupola without the help from a lot of people. So this isn't everybody, and my apologies, but just some particular folks. Also, lead was Kyle Brewer. Had a lot of help from Mike Steele, Pam Martin, Michelle Fitzgerald, Lisa Marzalek, Vince LaCourte, and Brandon Moncla. ECLIS, led by John Garr, with a lot of strong support from Megan Earn, and also Elise Sandvik. Odin was Eric Meyer, FAO, Mark Blanton, and Gail Hansen, who did a lot of timelines and changes, and thanks very much for that. Also, for folks that really helped put the mission together from the start, Falcon was Christy Matthew, Thor was Sean Robinson, ADCO was Todd Horlicia, and I'm sorry if I'm not getting some of these names right, and Cato was Jeff Cook. So thank you very much for all your great help and support, and you know, we're closing the story or closing the book on a great story, and a lot of it is you.
Thanks for those kind words.
It's a rare moment. I don't have any words.
Endeavour's crew there saying some final farewells to the International Space Station crew.
Commander George Zamka, and Pilot Terry Wirtz, with Mission Specialist Kay Heyer, Steve Robinson, Nicholas Patrick, and Bob Behnken, making their way to the Space Shuttle Endeavour, leaving behind Commander Jeff Williams and Flight Engineers Mike Sarayev, Oleg Kotov, Suichi Noguchi, and TJ Creamer. Two teams are now going to work on closing hatches between the two vehicles, a hatch on each side of a pressurized mating adapter that will take a few minutes before the official end of their time together comes. All this in preparation for tomorrow's undocking of Endeavour from the International Space Station, which is scheduled to happen at 6:54 p.m. Central. Flight Engineer TJ Creamer here, closing the International Space Station side of the hatch on the pressurized mating adapter. The shuttle side of the hatch closed at 2:08 a.m. Central Time, bringing to a close 9 days and 52 minutes that the two crews spent working together.
All two of our friends, Max and Oleg, visiting us on the space shuttle. We did have some visits from one end of the station to the other, and it was very nice to meet with those guys. It was a lot of fun. And this was our one of many attempts to try to get a group picture with the cupola, and it was actually a lot of fun because there were a lot of changing lighting effects from the cupola, constant changing. So we did take a series of pictures, and some came out great, some came out not so great, but we stuck with it, and we probably got one or two good ones in there. Cupola opening ceremony that we did today with the whole crew, all 11 folks. And with that, Cupola was officially open for business, and we had a nice plaque there with the moon rock and the rock from Mount Everest. One of the large lenses that I'm sure many pictures will be taken with over the years coming up with this new module that we have. And here's a nice view of the ARED machine is right there, which is an exercise machine, and then right below it is cupola. So here's Jeff putting our mission patch on the wall there. And I go back. This first patch that he did was the STS-129 patch, and then here is the STS-130 patch. Yeah, both putting that one on a wall with all the various space shuttle missions and expeditions that we've had to the space station. And that wall was in Node 1, looking into Node 3 there, and there's a table where we have some crew meals at. From the Soyuz that is docked at the FGB Nader, so it's the closest Soyuz spaceship to where the cupola is, and Oleg ran down and took some video for us, which is really nice. We'll just show this for a few minutes, the different crew members poking their heads up. Gentlemen, our Capcom asked us if it was more like a bat hanging or a gopher popping his head up, and we had one of each vote for those, and then we also had a looking in the bottom of a glass bottom boat. view of the space station in that area. You can see there's several different robotic arms, and there's a really neat view. You can see the Earth going by underneath and also peek a little bit inside the cupola. Taking a peek out at the Olympics right now. We just flew over Vancouver. We've been having some really nice night passes over the Olympics. Ceremony, a very sad time at the end of just an amazing, this is our 10th day back to the station, and it seems like the time, I've never had time fly so fast as I have for the last week and a half, but it was sad to say bye to those five folks out there. We got to be very good friends. You're backing through this tunnel with all these hatches and connectors sticking out, and I'm not sure how I did that. There you can see his feet. So you can see we went for that big, roomy space station, and here's the middeck. Just a few minutes after we close the hatches. You'll have a before and after video shot here coming up soon. He was getting eaten by that bag there. He got sucked down. He got eaten by Bag Hotel. And more people keep on coming out of the airlock. So we had a really nice treat tonight. I don't think it's going to come out here, but we had a chance to see the aurora, the northern lights, the aurora borealis, and it was really beautiful. Showed up really well with our eyes, but with the video camera, it didn't show up quite so well. So I try to do what I can, but it looks like it's not showing up. It was just in the minutes before sunrise. So there's, you can see sunrise on the Earth there. That's not the aurora. That's the sunrise itself. Okay, here's a little bit of sunrise. And this is looking out the pilot's window of the space shuttle, and you can see the Columbus module and the truss structure and some of the solar arrays there on top, and you can see the Earth in the distance. One of the great things about the human eye is that you can take all this in at once. With the camera, you have to zoom and change the focus and aperture and so on to be able to get it in, but when we look out, the view is so much better. And here's our middeck. Just about 30 minutes or an hour later, you can see all the work that Bob and Nick and Kay got done. Here's a video. I think this is the moon here. A few seconds. Okay, and here is what sunset and space looks like. Here's how fast it happens. Oh, I'm sorry, there's the gimbal flip. You can see the KU antenna moving. I thought Anko might have liked that. Okay, here's the sunset. And that's how it is on flight day 12.